This is an interview with Dr. Don Hopkins about his activities in the West Africa Smallpox Eradication Project. The interview is being conducted at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta, Georgia on July 14, 2006 as a part of the reunion, the 40th reunion of the West African Smallpox Eradication Project to mark the launch of the project. The interviewer is Victoria Harden. Dr. Hopkins, I would like to start at the beginning. You were born in 1941 in Miami, Florida. I want to establish who you were as a person and who was influential in making you who you are. Would you talk briefly about your childhood and pre-college education and discuss important people?
Sure. Well, I was born in 1941 in Coconut Grove, Florida, and lived the first 5 years about of my life then. My father was from the Bahamas. My mother had been born in Miami herself, but both of her parents were from the Bahamas. And at that time in Coconut Grove, where there was just this very tightly knit community. My mother was from a very big family, as was my father. And I had lots of aunts, uncles, and cousins around there. My godmother, my grandmother, and grandfather were just all within two or three blocks, literally, of where we lived. So it was from a big family. And I, from my earliest memories, I always wanted to be a physician. I don't know why. It was just there from the beginning. We moved when I was about 5 years old to northwest part of Miami, and there I did well in elementary school, went on to high school. When I was in 10th grade, I was asked to take an examination, and as a result of that, I was offered an early admission scholarship to Morehouse College in Atlanta, which I accepted after the 10th grade. In my early years, there were a lot of family around. We had the public health nurse, Nurse Mann, who was very helpful to us. But some of the teachers were in retrospect, very, very helpful. I remember, for example, that I hated kindergarten. And I know that my mother was worried about when it came time to go to first grade. But they had a little thing for the kids to get to meet their teachers the week before first grade was to start. My mother took me. It was only two blocks away from where we lived. And my mother, who was a seamstress, told the first grade teacher that I knew how to cut a straight line and on a piece of paper. So the teacher got out a piece of paper, drew a straight line on it, gave me a pair of scissors, and she just made such a big, "Oh, Donald, you know, you can cut a straight line." That gave me confidence. I was ready to go to first grade. When I got into college here at Morehouse, it was that also was just a very, very inspiring environment. And we had hammered into us from the day I set foot on that campus, weighing 87 and a half pounds, about 3 weeks before my 16th birthday. The message was, people who've come here have done well before you. You were expected to do well, and you must work hard to do well. Dr. Mays, who was the president then, my biology professors, Dr. Mapp and Bernie, and especially chemistry professor, Dr. Mike Bay, were all very, very inspiring and influential. And from there, I got a scholarship to University of Chicago Medical School.
Now this is, if I may, you were coming up in the South in the pre-civil rights era, and you lived through the civil rights period. Were there any experiences particularly that influenced you?
Well, the main thing I remember, I thank God many times that I didn't grow up in my parents' generation, because in Miami, things were difficult. And, you know, I was told, my parents remember the Ku Klux Klan parading down Grand Avenue and Coconut Grove and things like that. Fortunately, I didn't have any of that. The way it touched me was that the schools in Miami were segregated, and we were bused to the high school. My elementary school was within walking distance, but when it came time for high school, the students were bused so that whites could go to the white school and blacks to the black school. And in the black schools, of course, we had hand-me-down desks and books that we were aware of, but I don't remember that being an obsession for us. We were aware of it, but you know, we still continue to work hard. And in some instances, the teachers use that to try to help motivate it. And I know I just remember all of those very, very committed elementary and high school teachers, and even when I got into college.
Now, on one website that I was looking at last night, it was noted that in your senior year at Morehouse, you went to Egypt, and you were very struck by the number of people with trachoma. Now, you said you were already planning to become a physician, but would you talk about how that, what kind of impact that
When I was at Morehouse, the chairman of Morehouse's Board of Trustees, Charles E. Merrill, Jr., was making fellowships available to, I think it was four students from Morehouse and two students from Spelman each year to study for a year in Europe. $3,000, and that supported us and got us there for a year. I elected to go to Vienna. In the February of the academic year, we had a break between the two semesters, and four of us got together and went down to Greece, Istanbul, and Egypt. It was in Egypt that I saw what I now know was trachoma, but then it was just I could tell that these children had all these flies around their eyes, and they had some disease in their eyes, and lots of adults were having trouble with their eyes. That made me decide that when I got to medical school that I wanted to study tropical diseases. And fortunately, when I went to medical school, I came here to the University of Chicago Medical School. At that time, we had a professor in the microbiology department who was working on schistosomiasis, an awful parasitic disease. There was one other guy working on leprosy. Those were the two choices. The other very fortunate thing was that at that time, which was very unusual then, the University of Chicago had elective time in every quarter of the year, starting in the spring quarter of the freshman year, elective time to do research or take some other courses and things. And so I elected to work with Dr. Robert Lewart on schistosomiasis, and that just fed my interest in parasitic diseases. He took me under his wing and helped me publish my first paper and make my first presentation at a scientific meeting, and wrote recommendations for me also when it was time to do my internship.
Tell me about doing your internship, and I know you got an MPH at Harvard. Would you just walk me through the chronology?
Yeah, I did. After I finished medical school, I again, staying with infectious diseases, I decided to do an internship at San Francisco General Hospital. Coming out of University of Chicago, which at that time was a really tertiary referral hospital, I hadn't seen very much infectious diseases except very, you know, rare kinds of things. I saw only two cases of measles, for example, my senior year. So I wanted a more rounded experience. I didn't feel I was ready to be thrown into a situation like Cook County Hospital in Chicago. So I went to San Francisco General Hospital, which was a general hospital.
What year is this now?
I graduated from medical school in 1966. And so I was 1966-67 at San Francisco General Hospital. I really went to San Francisco to stay there in pediatrics. But after I had about 6 weeks of internship, I decided I needed a break from medical school and internship, so I applied to the Public Health Service. But I was also fortunate during my internship that my very first rotation was a month on a ward with 26 children with tuberculosis. And so again, this fed my interest in infectious diseases. I saw some cases of whooping cough then and lots of other things. But then I decided that I needed a break, that I was not going to go straight into pediatrics. And so I applied to the U.S. Public Health Service. And I put on my application that I was interested in infectious diseases, that I would like to work in Africa if I could. Some kind soul at Public Health Service, Washington, saw that on my application, knew that CDC was recruiting for the smallpox program. I had gone to college here in Atlanta, but I didn't know about CDC, and I certainly didn't know they were recruiting for the smallpox program. That person in PHS Washington sent my application to CDC. CDC sent me a brochure and a letter, and as soon as I saw that brochure, which I still have, I knew that was what I wanted to do. 20 years later, when I retired from CDC, Don Millar, who became head of the smallpox program, said that his view of that was, in his view, nothing good ever came out of Washington. And so when they received this letter from PHS Washington, it was they were skeptical. But they decided to have someone interview me, and we hit it off. And I was assigned to Sierra Leone. So.
In 1966, the Vietnam War was also heating up. Did you have a military obligation that the commission helped to satisfy?
I would have had a military obligation. In fact, several of my internmates from San Francisco General Hospital were assigned to work in Vietnam. And that was a consideration for me as well, because I knew temperamentally I was not set up to or fit to be in that kind of situation. So that was the motivation also in applying to the U.S. Public Health Service.
You arrived then, you came back to Atlanta, and you went through the training, I presume, the smallpox training. And then you arrived in Sierra Leone in 1967 and faced the highest incidence of smallpox in the world. Yeah. Would you tell me what you saw and explain why Sierra Leone had this high rate?
Well, my partner and I, Jim Thornton, were here in training together with others. And this was the second year of people who went out to the West Africa smallpox program. We were assigned to Sierra Leone. I remember vividly that even while we were still in training here, Sierra Leone was in the midst of an epidemic of smallpox. And the Ministry of Health of Sierra Leone sent a telegram here asking if we couldn't just stop our training and come on out, because they were so eager to get help. Of course, they didn't interrupt our training, but we arrived there in October of 1967, and at that time, Sierra Leone, and the following year, 1968, Sierra Leone had the highest rate of smallpox in all the countries in the world. So we did not have trouble persuading people to be immunized in Sierra Leone, by and large, because people knew what smallpox was, they knew, they feared it, and they wanted to be vaccinated. I viewed it as a challenge, because while we were here, part of the first group who had been assigned to Nigeria had been evacuated, including Bill Fagey. And I remember they were part of the people who were instructing us. And I remember Bill showing what they had been doing in Nigeria and how they were working. And I left here with the view that I wanted to show that we could be at least as effective as they had been in eastern Nigeria. And in Sierra Leone, we certainly had the opportunity to do that because there was so much smallpox. It was a compact country, and we had the advantage as well of having a just superb group of Sierra Leoneans with whom we worked. The senior guy, my main counterpart at the working level, was a guy named Alfred Cogbo Reffel, who had just returned from training as a rural environmental health kind of hygiene person in Britain. He was not a physician. This guy was extremely talented, but we were a little bit worried, my partner and I, about whether he would want to get out into villages and things, and we did not have to worry at all. He knew several languages. He was very skilled with people. He was a great guy to work with. And he and the team of about two dozen Sierra Leoneans really worked very hard. My partner, Jim Thornton, and I trained them. We then oversaw them and did all the reports and things, but they were just a great group of people to work with.
Now, when you first heard Bill Fagey talking about the what we now call surveillance and containment, the eradication escalation policy, not everybody embraced this. A lot of people were still looking at the we need to vaccinate 90% for the herd immunity. Yeah. What convinced you that his idea was the way to go?
Bill Fagey and the others broached the idea of the eradication, escalation, surveillance, containment strategy at the regional meeting. It was my first regional meeting, which was the one that was held in Abidjan in May of 1968. At that time, we had been in West Africa then for about 7-8 months or so since the previous October, and we'd had experience with the mass vaccination program already. And I don't know, I can't put my finger on anything specifically, except to say that when I heard it, it seemed to make a lot of sense to me. And so we agreed to do it in Sierra Leone. The Sierra Leone government and my partner Jim Thornton and I agreed to do it. And it certainly was, it did work very, very well. We had had one big outbreak that summer in August in a situation where a very prominent rural man, he was a bigwig in the local secret society, became ill with smallpox and died. Because he was so prominent, people came from miles around, from villages, to be at his sickbed, and then when he died after 3 days, the mourning and the funeral thing. And the first we heard of this outbreak was about 2 weeks later, when all these cases started appearing in villages. And when we put them on a map, we saw that there was this circle of places. And then we began interviewing the first case in each of these villages, and they all had in common that they had been to this man's funeral. So we went there and discovered lots of incredible things. I remember very vividly, though, that when we then fully mapped out all of this stuff, there was a hole in the map. And I asked, why aren't there any cases there? And it turned out that there was a river, and that the people who had been going to investigate, once we knew what was going on, had not gone to that point. And of course, when we said, you must go there as well, they went and found more cases of smallpox as well. The other very important thing about that outbreak was that when we arrived in the village, this man had two widows, one of whom had just given birth to a little girl. And this baby had been born to a mother who subsequently, within a few days after the child's birth, came down with smallpox herself. The co-wife also had smallpox, and the baby, having been born, was lying on a mat between these two women who had smallpox when I came in the village. And I was able to vaccinate that baby the very first day, and she lived, having been vaccinated then. But that was, about a third of that village of about 100 people got infected, the immediate village. All six people who washed that man's body got smallpox, and several of them died. And the whole outbreak was over 100 cases within two or three generations of smallpox.
And you used the surveillance containment policy in this situation?
In that situation and subsequently, we gave much greater emphasis to finding where cases of smallpox were and vaccinating around them. Up to then, we had been going counterclockwise around Sierra Leone with the mass immunizations. But with the surveillance containment strategy, we were able to ascertain where the cases were and then start vaccinating around them. And of course, at that time, we also had introduced, at about the same time, the bifurcated needle, where we had been using the mass vaccination jet injectors before. We also had the bifurcated needle. And we had started out with five mass immunization teams, one mop-up team, and one assessment team. The assessment team would go and do spot checks a week or so after that to see how many people had been. And if not enough people had been immunized, then the mop-up team would be assigned to go back and give remedial immunizations to other people, catch the other folks. Under the surveillance containment strategy, we reduced the number of mass vaccination teams, created two of the special intervention teams. And they would, when we found out about new cases of smallpox, follow up and immunize around them right away. And with that strategy, we had the last case of smallpox in Sierra Leone in April 1969.
How fast did you realize that it was really working so well?
Well, again, the nice thing about smallpox was that the incubation period was only 2 weeks. And so you could turn around every 2 weeks and know whether you had been effective or not, and if so, how effective you had been. I'm working now on guinea worm disease, an incubation period of 1 year, and that is a very, very much more difficult situation. But it was really motivating to have feedback so rapidly within 2 weeks to know whether you indeed had found all the people in that village and gotten them immunized, and that you had found all the cases of smallpox in the villages that needed to be immunized in the first place. Very rapid feedback, and it was motivating.
Some people were quite doubtful about whether smallpox could be eradicated as you started the mass vaccinations at the beginning. was this a turning point for you? When did you believe that it was going to happen?
I guess this was part of being young. I always believed, once I got into the program, that it could be vaccinated. And I think most of us did, I think. I certainly did from the beginning. I quickly realized, though, that this surveillance containment strategy was much more efficient. But I do have vivid memory from India, where I went to India after having done the Sierra Leone thing, went and served for 3 months in India in 1973. And at that time, I remember I was visited in West Bengal by an official from the Indian National Smallpox Eradication Program in New Delhi, who told me to my face that in his view, in 1973, we could come here from West Africa and all that, but he was Indian, he knew India, and smallpox was never going to be eradicated in India. I'd never forgotten that. That this was a man in the smallpox program who, so close to India's eradication, within 2 years of it, still did not believe himself that smallpox would be eradicated in India. That experience and the smallpox experience in West Africa for me forever immunized me against pessimists. And it just gave me the energy. We were starting the guinea worm eradication program not to be fazed at all by the people who didn't believe that it couldn't be done, because I had seen the smallpox thing go from it couldn't be done to it's done. And people towards the end, more and more, beginning to believe it could be done. That was me. It was several of my cohorts here from CDC in the smallpox world. But most importantly, it was true for the guys in West Africa as well, that they had seen, and ministries of health and the peripheral health workers had seen this program go from smallpox all over the place to get yourself together, you know, plan, do the epidemiology, and go at it systematically and intensively, and it will happen.
What was your most difficult problem while you were in West Africa?
I just remember being so full of enthusiasm then that to me it was always just a matter of time. In retrospect, I was afraid of snakes, so I always had some trepidation going out in rural areas. But as it turned out, I saw many more snakes in the first month I was in West Bengal, India, than I saw in the whole 2 years in Sierra Leone. I don't remember anything as difficult. I remember some things, and it's trite in a way to say challenges, but I don't remember difficulties in the sense of some of the frustrations I've had since in working in the guinea worm program and other programs of people who were very difficult to work with, or even institutions. I don't remember any of that, and I really don't think we had it.
That's one of the things that has really struck me here, is that the bureaucracy seemed to be much more flexible than mm-hmm. many bureaucracies mm-hmm. are, and willing to change and willing to experiment.
Well, one of the things, too, that younger people especially need to be reminded of, that, you know, I was out in West Africa for almost 2 years, and my wife and I went up to Europe for a vacation once. She came back to the States once, but other than that, I was in West Africa all of that time. We had visitors rarely from back in Atlanta, but the means of communications then was telex, and you had to be very concise in your language. Our telexes had to go through the U.S. embassies. You didn't have much space. Other than that, it was airmail, which took at least a week. And I never once spoke to anybody in Atlanta by telephone, because telephone communication was so expensive. And of course, email wasn't even thought of by then, that kind of thing. So it was a little bit like Thomas Jefferson being the U.S. minister to France. You didn't have a lot of intensive contact back, so you're pretty much off there on your own and needed to be creative. But the people at CDC were very flexible, and I was removed from the bureaucracy, not at the senior levels at that time, but they were very responsive, gave us all the things that we said we needed. Once or twice, I remember we wrote back and said we needed something, and it was a classic sort of the field feeling of, you know, those folks at headquarters don't understand what's going on. It was a matter of, I think, getting some new vehicles or something like that, as I recall. But otherwise, people were very flexible. And we who were out there on the front lines, just there was just the opportunity for such creativity in dealing with these various problems as you encountered them.
When the West Africa program was completed, you stayed with CDC and served as a consultant to the World Health Organization's effort to eradicate smallpox.
This would be a good time to change tape.
Got to change tape.
Okay. But Jim Curran probably will be there.
I have interviewed Jim Curran. He's
Please
one of my very favorite
beat
people.
On him. He needs to write a book about his experiences here. Because he needs to write a book about his experiences.
He's on my AIDS website, and I've got Dave Sencer's promised me an interview, Bill Fagey's promised me an interview, and several other people about. I've got the NIH story, and I've got to add the CDC story, and Peter Piot's going to talk too. So,
Jim remembers the days when. Before Surgeon General Koop got religion, for
yes.
example.
Oh, yes.
He also remembers the days before NIH got religion on AIDS. And he has lots of early stories.
Bob Gallo gives Jim Curran absolute credit for why he got into doing AIDS yeah. research at all. Yeah. That Curran got on his case. They yeah. were just chatting, you know, yeah. the informal yeah. sort of thing.
Jim's here today. I just saw him.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Good.
We're rolling, and we're good for 45 minutes nonstop.
Okay. Perhaps I should, before we start talking about the worldwide smallpox campaign, I should ask you if there's anything else that you think of that ought to be brought up about the West African work.
Well, one thing about the West African work was just the friendly sense of competition also between the different countries, or the teams in the countries, certainly the American teams in the different countries. And one of the most important experiences to me was the first regional meeting I attended, to hear from my colleagues. That meeting was in Abidjan in May 1968. And I remember distinctly the competition there between their countries. And I couldn't therefore wait until the next meeting in Lagos in May 1969. When we had our last case, as it turned out, in Sierra Leone. But I have used that experience as well in the current guinea worm eradication campaign in bringing together in program review the different country teams, in this instance, nationals, and getting them to compete with one another. And of course, they can't wait for the next meeting to come back and bring good results. I remember that as a very motivating experience. I also remember the importance, in retrospect, of the combining in West Africa of the measles control with smallpox eradication. And the one thing about that was that, in fact, it was U.S. government under President Johnson that went to the 20 countries in West Africa and offered to help with smallpox eradication. And it was the ministers of health of Africa, especially I recall hearing that it was the minister of then Upper Volta who insisted that they wanted this new measles vaccine in addition. And I think that's such an important model. And to put that in contemporary terms, I think the polio eradication program made a big mistake in not combining measles immunization with polio. Yes, it did slow down smallpox eradication a little bit. But my goodness, this is a generation ago we were able to do that, and surely we should have been able to do measles immunization along with polio immunization, because you still needed to keep polio vaccine cold, for example, just as measles vaccine. In the case of the smallpox and measles, we didn't have to keep the smallpox vaccination with a cold chain all the way out to the village, but we did it for the measles. And so, yes, it was a bit of a burden. But there was much more benefit, mutual benefit there. And I think that was another important aspect of the smallpox measles program in West Africa. And that was not repeated in any of the other areas. The final very big point about the West Africa smallpox program was that at that time in the global context, you had South America, mainly Brazil. You had West and Central Africa, where we were working. You had East and Southern Africa, Indian subcontinent, and the Indonesian islands. Of those five areas, West Africa was felt to be the most difficult, or Africa in general, but West Africa especially because there were so many people there. Lo and behold, that region, which was felt to be the most difficult, with the least infrastructure, et cetera, was the first one to get rid of smallpox of those regions. And that was another very important lesson, that even with those difficulties, with some outside help and funding, it was made to happen, even then.
You are an optimist, but I want to ask you to think, the malaria program, the malaria eradication program had not succeeded. It was decided that measles, because of its two-year cycle, we could do measles control, but not eradication. Polio seems to have come this close, but isn't quite there. Guinea worm is not quite there. Are we going to have any more eradicated diseases?
I think we definitely are going to have more eradicated diseases. Polio and guinea worm, I think, will both be eradicated. I'm certain of guinea worm. I think polio is very close with only four countries. And having had the disastrous malaria experience, which did bring a lot of benefits, but didn't, of course, achieve the target of eradication, polio eradication must succeed. If polio eradication were not to succeed, the backlash from that would be much worse than even measles eradication, than even malaria eradication, because so much has been invested in polio eradication. So I think polio eradication must succeed. I don't follow it that closely. I know they're down to four remaining endemic countries now. But with guinea worm, we're at the last 0.5%, and 95% of what's left is in southern Sudan and northern Ghana. And we're closing in on that. So I think that will happen. And after that, there will be others. I think that measles is going to be vaccinated. It will be eradicated. I don't know how soon. I know some areas, the Americas, for example, southern Africa has interrupted much of the transmission already. I think that's going to come. I think lymphatic filariasis will be another disease that will be targeted likely for eradication as well, and potentially onchocerciasis or river blindness. We're getting rid of river blindness now in the Americas. It's entrenched in Africa, Eastern and Central Africa. But I think there will be undoubtedly other diseases because new tools will come along as well. But I think one has to pick and choose very carefully because these are very intensive events. They're very demanding. They're very expensive. As compared to a control program, you have to go everywhere where those diseases are. And if country X only has what is to them a trivial amount of disease, somebody has to come from outside and help provide resources to do that. Because in the context of country X, they don't need to focus on this. But the world needs to focus on it if it's going to get rid of it everywhere. And so that's an important principle. So they're very intensive events. One must be selective. But on the positive side, that is a very powerful tool. It's motivating to the people who work in it. It's good for the people who have been suffering from those diseases. And it's one more thing out of the way. Now, West Africa still has a lot of problems, a lot of problems. But they don't have smallpox to worry about anymore. And I believe that soon they're not going to have guinea worm disease to worry about anymore. So the more of those things you can strip away, no, and you know, in the greater scheme of things, I don't know that it's reduced the total number of people who died, et cetera, but it's certainly made a difference in the lives of a lot of families. And I remember I went back to Sierra Leone for the first time more than 10 years after I left at the end of the eradication campaign. I went out, I was at CDC in charge of international health stuff. I went out to look in on the Lassa fever station that we had, and I remember going out to one of the villages there in the eastern part of the country. And first of all, it was strange for me to be going out into villages and not be looking for smallpox. But the other thing that struck me was that we were out in the village and there were just these clouds of children, young children around cheering and stuff, looking at these foreigners. And I realized that none of these children had ever seen a case of smallpox, that had to worry about smallpox, and maybe hadn't even ever heard of smallpox. And that was a good feeling.
Indeed. Let's talk a little bit about your work in India and the global eradication campaign. Would you, the relationship of CDC to WHO and what have you?
I was had come back to CDC, was in the planning office, and was offered an opportunity to go and work again with smallpox in India. Now, after I left Sierra Leone, I had done 2 weeks in 1971 helping to train the first group of Ethiopian sanitarians and U.S. Peace Corps volunteers there. So the stint in India, 3 months in the fall of 1973, was my third and last encounter with smallpox. I had not been to India before. I did not expect to like the country as much as I did, but I recall that the smallpox there, though it was the same disease, was much tougher. And primarily it was much tougher because the density of human population there in West Bengal was much greater than what we'd had in West Africa. And that was my most vivid memory. That and the fact that the difference between smallpox transmission during the dry season and the rainy season was very sharp. I arrived at the tail end of the rainy season. And I remember going into some areas there south of Calcutta, chasing smallpox then in the beginning, and going back to some of the same areas later in November or so during the dry season. In the rainy season, you heard about a case of smallpox, and you went there, you'd immunize and stuff, and you could get on top of it. During the dry season, under similar circumstances, by the time you got to that village, the thing had spread. It was just the seasonality of that disease was palpable, and it was very, very striking. And the combination of that and the much greater population density, where in West Africa, there were several instances where we, you know, did our mass vaccination. We got to 80% or 85% of the population. And generally, if smallpox came into a village like that, that you had immunized to that level, it would be stopped. Measles, on the other hand, in West Africa, would keep going with 15% of people still unimmunized there. In India, even 10 or 5% of people unimmunized still meant a lot of unimmunized people per square mile. So many, in fact, so that the disease could keep going. I have two memories of just face-to-face encounters, one being of a baby who was just a very healthy, well-fed infant at a time when there was famine in West Bengal. And this child had had when I saw him, had been immunized, it appeared. There was smallpox in the village. The child was cranky when I saw him, but the local health guy had immunized this child because he was afraid that this rash that appeared in the village was smallpox. The rash had been diagnosed as chickenpox, but the guy was being extra cautious. But despite that, the health person did not check whether the vaccine had taken or not, whether the vaccination had taken or not. It had not taken. The disease was smallpox. The baby got smallpox and unfortunately died. And I followed that child over the course of the few weeks of his prodrominant illness, and he died. The other encounter was in a different village. We went into this village. Smallpox was there. It was not an abstraction. It was killing people in this village. And we were there to help vaccinate the villagers. But this one middle-aged man was irate. And he said to me and to my companions, he said, if you guys are here from the from the government of India, we don't need smallpox vaccination, we need food. And he said, I would rather die quickly from smallpox than starve to death. I've never forgotten that. And I remember once Dave Sencer, then the director of CDC, asked me once when I was being debriefed and I came back, you know, how do you feel about that? What do you do? And I said, well, you know, what can we do? We couldn't stop. I wasn't there to bring food. I had no means of bringing food to this village. The only thing I could do for this village was smallpox immunization. And I think the important lesson for people is you can't fix everything at once, and you have to do what you can. But it also reminded me that there are lots of problems out there.
Oh, yes. Maybe I will just take that one step further and ask you to comment on what problems stand in the way of things most, religious, the political, the social, and what does it take to overcome them?
Well, in India, one of the differences from my experience in Sierra Leone was this worship of the smallpox goddess in India was more of a problem than, in Sierra Leone, we did not have worship of a god in that part of West Africa. But of course, in India, that was there. And for some people, that was very serious. It meant that they sometimes would not report people that had smallpox. It meant that sometimes they would refuse vaccination. In West Bengal, we had people from the adjoining state of Bihar who were notorious for resisting smallpox immunization, and that was difficult. All you can do, in my experience, in that situation is to try to help people understand. I'm convinced that unless a person is certifiably crazy, people are rational. And while these people are all doing what they genuinely believe to be the best for themselves and their families, nobody deliberately does something to harm their families unless they're mentally unstable. Our job as health professionals is to try to help them understand what we know to be true, that in the case of smallpox, being at risk of smallpox, the most important thing to do to protect yourself and your family is to get vaccinated, not to resist vaccination. But that's a very tough thing in some situations, and one just has to continue to work with the people.
I was going to say, medical scientific knowledge alone, your understanding of the data just is not enough. You have to make that connection.
We've seen many times, and this has been brought home to me even more strongly in the Guinea Worm Eradication Program, the importance of social science with all of this. Understanding what people believe, why they believe it, what are the best ways of approaching them, who are the opinion makers and the influential people in the various communities. We tend to get very fixated on the technology, be it, you know, the vaccine or the jet injectors or the drug that we have to give people to get rid of these things. But we neglect at our peril the social science, because that's always a very important thing. Even if we have what we think is the ideal vaccine or the ideal drug to give people once a year by mouth with no side effects, people still have reasons in their own context to be wary. I will say also that one of the most powerful and influential legacies of the smallpox program to me comes from that very first brochure that CDC sent me when I was an intern in San Francisco General. In there was a graph showing time, the proportion of people that needed to be vaccinated in West Africa. And then we tracked over the smallpox program how close actual vaccinations were coming to the projected vaccination. That just burned into my brain, that and other things, the importance of quantitative objectives as a motivator and as a clarifier. And I see as one of the challenges of public health programs, domestic, international, whatever, being to develop objectives that are quantifiable and that can be tracked so that you know whether you're on, behind, or ahead of schedule, but that so that you also lock people's attention onto a handful of things. I have several instances like inside of some programs when I was here at CDC and others where people feel they're doing good and they're counting what they're doing, but they're not looking at the right objectives. They're not looking at the most important things, or they're looking at too many things, or they're not measuring anything. But if you have broken this down to a situation where this is where we are, this is where we want to be whenever, and this is where we need to be in between, and what you're measuring is directly related to what you want to do, you can't go wrong that way, because you'll know if you're falling behind, then you need to look and find and know that you're falling behind and figure out what's wrong, and otherwise you won't. But it's a very important motivator. I spoke earlier about this 2-week incubation period. We had a couple of Peace Corps volunteers over the 2 years I was in Sierra Leone who worked for us in the smallpox program. Now, the young Peace Corps volunteers as a group, are voluble, very enthusiastic young people, as we were, though we were a little bit older than them then. But the two Peace Corps people we had working with us in the smallpox program in Sierra Leone were even more energetic than their Peace Corps mates, because we had these measurable objectives, whereas the other people were saying, oh, well, you know, I'm in my village, I'm supposed to help them, you know, build this or that or the other, but, you know, you never really know when you get to the end, et cetera. But to be able to have a scorecard every 2 weeks, and in fact, as you're rolling along, you've really got a scorecard every week, because that was the other exciting thing about the smallpox program, was the data coming in. In fact, despite the last, whatever it's been, 45 minutes or so here today, I don't like talking about smallpox as much as I do about the guinea worm eradication campaign now, because the guinea worm eradication is evolving. And I remember that in the smallpox program. It was very exciting getting the news from the countries or from the different parts of Sierra Leone when I was there each week, or even more frequently than that. I'm sort of freewheeling here now. But I recall also, I'm amused now when we hear people in the guinea worm program bemoan the fact that their computers are broken and that they don't have a computer to help them manage this data, where the cases are far fewer than smallpox and much more slowly evolving, and pencil and paper worked fine. And we didn't need a computer to draw maps for us or to put dots on maps and things to get a good bird's eye view. Don't get me wrong, I'm very much aware of how much more and how much faster computers can do things, which are an advantage. But people need to recall that there's a lot to be done. The most important computer is here with pencil and paper. And I will point out that the pitfall of these computers, particularly making calculations of, I've seen young people make all kinds of calculations and then try to guess which one is meaningful, when in the days when you had to do it by hand or more manually, you thought very carefully about what calculations you were going to make, because they took time. And I still think that discipline is good.
I'll bet you even remember slide rules.
Oh, yes, I remember slide rules.
The thing about a slide rule was that you didn't know where the decimal point was, so you had to use your brain to get a ballpark figure so you knew where to put the decimal point. And this is what you're talking about here. You have to use some common sense and know whether your data is good enough to do a regression on.
I remember even before slide rules, my freshman year of college, the most feared professor on the campus was that Professor McBay, chemistry. And in chemistry, we had lots of calculations to make, and I had to do those, and several of my cohort, by hand, including on examinations. All that multiplication and division. My sophomore year, some of the professors in biology took pity on us and taught us how to use slide rules. And so I used a slide rule from then on. But again, 39 years ago, when I was in training here at CDC, there were these hand credits. They looked like cash registers, the machines that you'd use to do calculations on. And it was important to know your timetables then.
Absolutely. What impact did the smallpox program have on your family?
Well, my wife and I had just gotten married the month before I came here to CDC to begin training. So we had our first 2 years of marriage was there in Sierra Leone. And those were wonderful, wonderful years. Remember them very fondly, and of course, the camaraderie of the other people in the smallpox program. I came back and did a Master of Public Health at Harvard School of Public Health in Boston, then did 2 years of pediatrics in Chicago, all of that still on CDC out-of-service training, then came back to CDC. So I guess we had the formative experience in West Africa. My wife didn't tolerate hot weather very well, but we had a lot of fun there together that first time. I also remember, in regard to my family, that when I came back from Sierra Leone, I was sitting on the floor in my parents' house in Miami, and I started saying, my mother started saying, "You know your uncle," and she only got that far when I immediately realized that one of my father's brothers, named DeWitt, who lived in Philadelphia, we didn't see them very often, he had had smallpox. I remember as a child, when they would come and visit us in Miami, this man had this horribly pockmarked face. But I had not thought of that the whole time I was in Sierra Leone fighting smallpox. I hadn't thought about it. But as soon as she started that sentence, I immediately connected that with my uncle. My God, because I'd seen, of course, so many people scarred in West Africa, and I realized that. So I had seen smallpox as a child without, or at least the results of smallpox, without even having known it. And I now know that that uncle was one of the ones who was in Florida, had epidemics of smallpox in the 1920s, as in much of the United States. And my father subsequently told me that my father remembered visiting that brother of his in Jackson Memorial Hospital when my uncle had had smallpox there. So I was just intrigued that I had seen smallpox, but that had not, it had not registered the whole time there, because we didn't see those uncles. There were three of my father's brothers lived in Philadelphia, and we didn't see them very often. But we always remembered how badly pockmarked this uncle's face was, and I had not connected that smallpox.
Before we stop, is there anything else that you would like to say about the program?
The main thing I would say is that that was such a formative experience for me. It was obviously so good for the people in West Africa, for the ministries of health in West Africa. I remember also, by way of the value of symbols and motivating people, that once I was in the office of the chief medical officer in Freetown, Sierra Leone, and I had put a map of Sierra Leone there. And every month or so, I would go in and color in blue the districts that had been mass vaccinated. And as this map was filling in, the chief medical officer told me that many of the people coming into his office would all, you know, lock on to that map. And I remember his deputy asked us for another copy of that map. But that was another way of motivating people. But overall, that was such a formative experience for all of us who were in that program. I would wish, my wish really would be, that everybody going into public health could have a comparable experience early. The flip side of that is for people who get into a negative public health experience from the beginning, that is terrible, because public health is so exciting, it's bad. But for people to have this kind of experience in early in their careers is very important. It is dissatisfying in the sense that most of us came back thinking, perhaps naively, that the rest of our public health careers would be that way. Much of mine, I have to say, has been, but that's the exception rather than the rule. And I take a great satisfaction now in having created this skinny worm eradication program, which is giving another generation of Americans, Africans, and others a similar kind of experience. The feedback is slower, but still every month we're able to look and see how we're doing compared to the same month last year. So it's not quite like smallpox, but the principles are the same. Of break it down to measurable, manageable bits, track those, and it's very exciting business.
Thank you so much for a very, very,
very
fine
welcome.
Interview. I appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you. Thank you.